Welcome to Classic Album Sundays Worldwide. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and on this edition, I'll be exploring our album of the month, Homogenic by Björk. From my first listen to the Sugar Cube's debut album, Life's Too Good, at my college radio station, WNYU, I've been fascinated by Björk. Her strikingly expressive voice that can leap from a howl to a whisper, her playful use of the English language, her single-mindedness as an artist, and the gravitas of her performance and presence has always been compelling. I also greatly admire how she's kept her fans on their toes whilst wrapped around her finger. Björk is one of the few artists that can sell millions of albums whilst marrying her unique brand of pop with a deep love of the avant-garde and electronic pioneers like Karlheinz Stockhausen. She interviewed him in 1996 and wrote, "When Karlheinz harnessed electricity into sound and showed the rest of us, he sparked off a sun that is still burning and will glow for a long time." She had already made an album of traditional folk songs that made her a national star at the age of 11. So her 1993 album debut technically wasn't her first solo effort, and it certainly didn't pick up where the Sugar Cubes left off. In fact, she later claimed that she wasn't even into the music of the Sugar Cubes and seemed to almost take a background role, raising her young baby on tour and shying away from interviews. So she decided it was time for a new start in a new place with a new attitude and moved to London. And it was here where she met her future collaborators and my special guest, Guy Sigsworth. Hi, Guy. Thanks so much for joining me.
Yeah, lovely to be here.
Now, just to give you the 411 on Guy, he worked with Björk on Post, Homogenic, Dancer in the Dark, and Vespertine. He was the musical director of her live band for both the debut and Post albums. He also co-wrote songs on Seal's debut, worked with Bomb the Bass, Talvin Singh, Imogen Heap. He also has a band with her called Frou Frou, Alanis Morissette, Alison Moyet, Robin, Lamb, Sugar Babes, Britney Spears, which is probably the first and last time that name will be mentioned on Worldwide FM, I expect. Sorry about that, Guy. And he also has his debut solo album coming out next year. So tell us how you met Björk.
I met Björk through Talvin Singh. Talvin got involved in debut on the string arrangement for Venus is a Boy.
My favorite song on the album. Mm.
And so after that, when Björk wanted to form a band to perform the record, it started with her, me, and Talvin, and then we needed more players, and it grew to a seven-piece band.
Wow. And so what was she like at that time?
Oh, fantastic. I mean, I already did know how wonderful her singing was, like you, from the Sugar Cubes records, which were gorgeous, and I loved what I was hearing this record, so it was a dream gig.
I know at that time she was really frequenting the underground nightlife of London. Did you ever accompany her in any of these forays?
I probably wasn't the sort of big club person that other people might have been at that time. But I mean, London was just full of energy at that time. And there were always these new mutant forms of dance music evolving. You know, then you had drum and bass and all that stuff. So it was just a wonderful place.
A lot of energy.
Yeah.
And it seems like she really fed off that with her music.
Yeah.
And then when it came time for Post, it seemed like she even went deeper into it, into like the deeper kind of underground of the London underground scene. So did you kind of feel that when you started working with her on Post, that she was actually, it wasn't like just housey, it was really getting into like trip hop and, you know, IDM, electronica, and of course morph with string arrangements this time by Deodato.
Yeah, I think Post, you can hear, is it's less of a straight dance record. I mean, I don't even think Debut's a straight dance record, but it's got more kind of classic 4/4 tunes.
Yeah, it does. It has the Talvin Singh's kind of string arrangements, so it definitely is morphed, but I found Post to be more experimental, really.
Yeah.
Do you think that she was going a bit deeper on that one?
Yeah, I think she was not somebody who was going to be content to just remake her previous records.
Yeah.
So I think each one was a step forward into a new territory.
How do you think London really affected her work at that time?
Well, it's tricky to say. I think those things do affect you, but it's not easy to say, well, it's that kind of bass sound or it's that kind of drum sound. It's just the atmosphere of it.
And do you think maybe it's the energy of the clubs that maybe it's bringing her personality out a bit more, making her a little bit more extroverted, perhaps?
Yeah, and I think that there were specific musicians that she would hear their work and be really inspired. And, you know, that was also a golden period of Warp Records. bringing a whole generation of interesting electronic artists to the public, whether it was Aphex Twin and Orteca and Mark Bell and all those people who were associated with Warp.
Mm-hmm. Now, she worked with a lot of different collaborators on this. She brought back Nellie Hooper, 808 States, Graham Massey, Howie B, Tricky, and she also produced herself. But you also contributed to the album Post on a song called Cover Me.
Yeah.
Can you tell me about that?
Yeah, my background is a bit unusual because I started off in classical music and particularly early music, playing all these cranky early instruments. And Björk really embraced that. And we'd already done an unplugged MTV show where I got harpsichords and clavichords and pipe organs and everything involved. So on that song, I'm playing harpsichord, but it's using this stop that makes it almost sound like a Japanese koto.
What was it like working with her on that particular song?
It was just great. Her music is so much about the actual performance as well. There's always this performance element. It's not just assembling sounds on a record. There's a strong element of performance in all of her records.
So do you mean when she's actually recording the vocals, it's almost like a performance?
Yeah, and me too. I was giving performances, and then, you know, it wasn't massively edited. It was just finding the moment when you get the best performance. You know?
And so a lot of it's first takes?
Some of it is, yeah. And if it's, you know, you're waiting for that magic spark when the interaction is great.
Ken Scott, I was with Ken Scott over the weekend. He produced Ziggy Stardust. He said the same thing about David Bowie.
Right.
That David Bowie was mainly, he was like performing in the studio, and all of those songs are first takes pretty much. So
yeah.
You can see Björk is a very conceptual artist, much like Bowie in that sense. And so I can now understand how the actual studio atmosphere could be a performance as well.
Oh, yeah.
Let's have a listen to Björk Cover Me from her album Post on Classic Album Sundays Worldwide. From her album Post, that's Björk with Cover Me on Classic Album Sundays Worldwide. Now, to this day, Björk commands a dedicated following who wait with bated breath to see what she'll deliver next. However, there were some fans who found her mercurial musical nature quite difficult to grasp. So for her LP following Post, she strove for more of a singular flavor throughout, about as close to homogeneousness as she could get. Hence the title Homogenic. In many ways, she took a cue from Stockhausen, of whom she said, he celebrated the sound of sound in both his electronic music and his acoustic music. Well, with me in the studio is Guy Sigsworth, who worked with Björk on this album. And you're also a Stockhausen fan.
Yeah, I had a friend at school who was a real Stockhausen nut, and he would play me all his records, and a lot of them went over my head, but there were a couple that really stuck. And one of them was his album Song of the Youth, and I loved the weird electronic cut-ups of the voices. And in fact, later when Björk went to interview Stockhausen, I got her to get him to sign my copy. So I've actually got Karl Heinz's autograph on my record.
Stockhausen groupies.
Yeah. We're a small group, but we all know each other because...
It's a tight-knit community. Now, originally she wanted to produce Homogenic herself, but she decided to bring in some collaborators. And she did do a lot of the initial work herself. She got into Marcus Drauss, I believe, who was a collaborator of Brian Eno's. And she got him into her London home studio and they began writing. And then she recruited, of course, Mark Bell of LFO. He was a big inspiration to her, wasn't he?
Yeah, I love Mark's work and I really miss him. I think he had a way of all those warp artists who are doing kind of quite experimental beats. There's something about Mark's approach that's always very rooted and physical. It never becomes totally divorced from the body, if you know what I mean, in the way that some very geeky electronica can do. It still has that heft. Mm. And that's why I think he's a great sort of pivot in his beats to her. I think it's just wonderful.
That's a great description. Really, yeah. Really yeah. Well put. Now, Björk has a real unique approach as a singer, too. We were just talking earlier about how she's a real performer. I mean, how do you think... I remember reading once that she said she went out into like the landscape in Iceland and would sing at the top of her lungs when she was a child. What's it like working with her as a singer?
Oh, it's thrilling. I mean, on stage, I loved it because every night I had the best seat in the house to hear her sing. I think actually one of the most wonderful things about being a musician on stage is just listening to other people rather than just celebrating your own greatness. And I just loved hearing her sing. And I never felt she gave less than 100% every night, you know.
Mm-hmm. And you can hear that in her vocals too. I mean, it is always 100%. Even if it's a whisper, it's 100% whisper. Now, as a producer, she wanted to take a bit more control. What's she like working with as a producer?
I think that she's fascinating because there's normally a challenge, and challenges are fun, because replicating what's already been done is kind of boring. So making the impossible possible is a wonderful thing to try and do.
Absolutely. It seems like that's what she tries to do herself. Yeah. And also as a writer, what is she like as a writer? Because you've co-written together.
Yeah. I don't always know where other... I mean, it's funny, you write songs with other people, you're never quite sure where they draw their magic from. I think she probably has lots of ideas darting around and then they suddenly find an outlet. I imagine it's like that. I think that's probably how I write music as well.
Well, the next song we're going to listen to is one that was produced by Mark Bell, which is called Immature. And from what I understand... that one could have been written shortly after her breakup with Goldie, but maybe you don't know anything about that.
I don't know.
All right. Well, let's have a listen to Björk with Immature. Immature by Björk on Classic Album Sundays Worldwide. Now, we're celebrating the album Homogenic, which is our album of the month, and the name really suggests the concept of home. While recording, she revealed to a magazine, Jam, "I'm really seeking after something that's Icelandic, and I want it to be more me, this album." Home, of course, was her native Iceland, and she used the Icelandic string quartet on the album. And on the song Unravel, one of the album's highlights and a favorite of Tom York, she used a traditional Icelandic choir singing technique, which was a combination of speaking and singing. Guy Sigsworth, who is my guest in the studio today, he co-wrote and co-produced and played clavichord, keyboards, and pipe organ on this song. So tell us the story behind the creation of Unravel.
Well, Björk went to Spain, actually, to record most of the record, because Trevor Murray, who was the drummer in the post band, he had the studio in Spain. And it was a wonderful retreat from all the sort of chaos of London. And I was mostly out there in London, and I'd flown out to play on a couple of other songs. And then we were talking over the phone about, well, let's go and do something else together. And we were trying to arrange diaries. And then the irony was, by the time there was time we could get together, we actually did it in London. And I was preparing this backing track where I was actually working with another band. And then I had to take my gear home every night, put it on headphones and create this track for her. Something that I thought would fit with the character of what I'd already heard. And then we actually went to Rack Studios in London. And I played her my backing track. And she went for a walk and wrote the lyrics and picked up a handheld SM58 microphone, you know, one of those live mics you can drop on the floor and pick it up and carry on singing. And she sung two takes, a lead and a backing vocal, and that was the record.
Oh my gosh.
So it's probably the most quickly executed record I've ever been involved in my entire career.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
Now, when you listen to it, do you think it has an Icelandic feel at all?
I think it does, although I don't know quite how I've absorbed that, except I suppose I did go and visit there when we played, I think we played in 1994 for the anniversary of Icelandic independence, which is when she sung the entire of debut in Icelandic, which was quite a shock to us in the band because we couldn't really follow. All the melodies had to be slightly twisted to fit the Icelandic lyrics.
Of course. Did it take longer or was it shorter?
No, it took just the same. It's just funny. I think she had crib sheets written all over the stage to remind her what the Icelandic words were, because I think she might have written some of the songs in Icelandic originally and translated them. Which I think by Homogenic, I think she was definitely writing in English.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's so interesting. I never knew that. And I interviewed her for that album too. So
right.
you've revealed something new to me.
Yeah, I think it was Spike told me that he'd heard the demos for debut and they had Icelandic vocals on them.
Wow. Now, I've been to Iceland before myself as well, and it is incredible. The landscape is just so, it's like walking on the moon.
Oh, yeah.
And I've seen the northern lights there, and there is a certain majesty to it, I would say. And I really kind of feel that in this song, Unravel.
Yeah. I think it's curious, isn't it? Because on the one hand, it's this lunar landscape. On the other hand, because it is is a country with a very small population. It's the classic thing, like everybody kind of knows everybody as well.
Yeah.
So it's a village and it's the moon.
I know, this is so funny because I was walking down the street in Reykjavik, which was kind of like one main street. I was with my friend and everyone's like, hey, how you doing? It was like the small town that I grew up in, and it was like the capital of the country.
Yeah.
Anyways, let's have a listen to Björk with Unravel.
Why are you
Björk with Unravel from her album Homogenic, our album of the month on Classic Album Sundays Worldwide. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy. Now, this album also conjures a shifting idea of home as the album was finished in Malaga, Spain, the edge of the European continent, and where Björk went after two traumatic events, her much-publicized attack on an intrusive reporter who approached Björk's young son at Bangkok Airport, and the suicide incident in which stalker Ricardo Lopez was so upset by Björk's relationship with drum and bass artist Goldie that he posted her a mail bomb and then videoed himself committing suicide whilst listening to her music. Now, my guest in the studio, Guy Sigsworth, went to Malaga, and I just wanted to ask you, what was her mood like when you arrived? I mean, was she feeling quite fragile, or was she feeling defiant, or both?
I wasn't the first one out there, so I think things had settled down into a kind of routine, but I definitely felt by that point she was very productive, very taking care of business and really getting involved in the music, and there was a real team atmosphere. And I think Trevor's studio is very home-like as well. He's got fantastic cooks, and so the social life around making the music is wonderful. And that helps enormously.
And now, was there a song that she had penned maybe referring to this incident?
I heard what was going to be the album in its complete run. There was a song called So Broken, which was in the middle of the record, which was her with two flamenco guitars, which I think she'd done very soon after arriving in Spain. And I think it got taken out of the record because it doesn't really fit sonically with a record that's string quartets and distorted drums. Flamenco guitars aren't really part of that. And it did surface later as a bonus track on other songs. But you can kind of tell that that's definitely comes from that time period, I think.
Well, it's interesting because when you look at the record, at the album cover of Homogenic, the cover was designed by Alexander McQueen. And it looks like Björk is this kind of warrior princess. And I almost get this feeling of defiance and strength when I look at this picture. And maybe this is the kind of attitude she had to adopt to get herself through these horrific events.
Yeah, it could be that. I think it's a wonderful cover, isn't it? Because I don't know, when I look at covers, I always think if every cover has to be a portrait, does it get kind of boring? And it never does with her. She always finds a way to take that fact, it's still a portrait of her, and take you to a new place with it, you know.
I love that. So yeah. I was lining them all up actually recently and looking at them like, wow, that's really cool, this whole progression.
Yeah.
And she has a new album coming out too, so I'm interested to see what that one's going to be.
Yeah.
Do you think the writing process for her while she was in Malaga, do you think it was a healing process?
I don't know. I imagine so. I think I don't think the record is primarily like a response to that guy's suicide. I think it's that may just be one detail. I think there's lots of interesting human stories. I mean, when you write, I think you have to get things out. I think it's about that, really.
Well, she's since described Homogenic as her most extroverted album, and it sounds like she's almost hardened by the traumas she had to deal with as a pop star. Especially, you can hear this on the opening song, Hunter, where she defiantly shows she refuses to be the hunted victim. Let's have a listen.
Searching. So you left me on my own to complete the mission. Now I'm leaving it all behind. I'm going hunted. I'm the hunter.
Sweet.
With All Neon Like and Hunter on Classic Album Sundays Worldwide. And my special guest in the studio today is Guy Sigsworth, and you also played on All Neon Like.
Yeah, I remember going out to Spain to play on that with Alistair Malloy, who plays the wine glasses. he played one of the Unplugged shows with us. And it was one of those funny ones where we got to the studio in good early time when everybody else was still in bed. And we were listening to the backing track that we had to play on and writing out our parts. And it's one of those funny things that happens, which is we heard Mark's beat the wrong way around. We heard it upside down. So it's like what we thought was the first beat was actually the third beat. And it's one of those funny things where we'd already learned the song. And then when we tried to play, realizing the correct way around, we just made a mess of it. So we had to like re-trick ourselves to hear it the wrong way around, and then we could play it properly. And I don't know if that's too much of a muso thing, but those things do happen to you sometimes. You get locked into a certain way of hearing the thing.
Yeah.
And then when somebody does a phase shift and shows you, no, it's you're seeing it sideways on, mm-hmm. but it's like you can't relearn it. it's deeply stuck in your subconscious. So it's quite funny to see us kind of tricking ourselves in order to play it correctly.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to talk to you about this, something that you and Björk have in common, which is your classical music training. I mean, she began her classical training at the age of 5, but she later right. stormed out of music school when she was a 15-year-old punk, when she decided that classical music sucked, and she wasn't happy that the school wasn't really teaching any Icelandic composers either. Mm. But in Homogenic, she really turns her gaze back to her classical roots, and she really shows her love of violin and cellos, which she called a chamber music mentality. Mm. Now, you trained very early in harpsichord, I believe?
Yeah, that's right. I grew up in the Yorkshire Dales, and my dad only listened to classical music, so that's all I heard at first. And I suppose looking for my rebellion within that, I just really got into the very, very early music. People who played these freaky instruments where the mainstream classical people just thought, you know, you only play that instrument, you know, you only play the harps good because you can't play the piano properly, or you only play these instruments because you're not good enough to play the violin properly or whatever. And I like that because they were the kind of misfits of the classical world. Mm-hmm. They were the eccentrics. And in a way, maybe that's also become a bit more normalized now. We're quite used to these old instruments. But at the time, you were kind of staking out new ground if you wanted to play these strange and exotic instruments.
Absolutely. I mean, at the end of the Beatles introduced a celeste on the White Album, yeah. which is quite
Yeah, and then in fact, they did use harpsichords on, I think, Piggies, and there's mm-hmm. lots of other things where they were into that. And because these were like new colors, I think, that colors that had been forgotten.
Yeah, absolutely. Obviously, we know Johnny Greenwood does that to great effect as well. You were also, you toured with the European Union Baroque Orchestra. Yeah. I mean, it's interesting that this kind of background, but it seems like you really breathe new life into these instruments very much in the same way Björk does.
I think one thing that's curious about, I mean, when I think about getting the gig with the European Baroque Orchestra, I wasn't the best technical harpsichordist, but I was a good accompanist. And I actually enjoy accompanying people, and maybe it's why I really enjoyed being, you know, accompanying Björk on stage, because being behind somebody and having that kind of interaction with them is more important. I enjoy that more than shredding as the star, you know?
Well, you don't know that yet, because your debut solo album's coming up.
Yeah, but I'm a very self-facing soloist. I'm not the Van Halen of the harpsichord, you know.
I want to hear Eruption on the harpsichord. I think that'd be really interesting. One of the most glorious kind of examples of the meeting of strings and electronic experimentation, I think, on the album is this song called Yoga. Can you tell us about that song?
I remember when Spike had just finished mixing it, and Derek Burkett driving us out in his car and playing it at massive volume, and I was there with Mark Bell and Björk, and when those distorted drums kick in the middle particularly, it was just elating. I still remember just thinking, wow, this is incredible, this is such a sort of an achievement, this to make noises that odd and yet so direct and powerful, and I was just grateful to be around when it happened. I guess I knew, because when we were touring post, the touring schedule got very heavy, and I think sometimes when people book tours and they don't think about singers, they forget that if you have to sing 7 nights a week, you're going to lose your voice. And especially a singer like Björk, who really doesn't hold back, and she did start to have real sort of health problems trying to keep up the routine of what we were doing. And at that point, Yoga, her friend, came out and was doing every kind of help to get her through it. And I think the song, as far as I understand it, is a sort of glorious thank you to Yoga.
Well, let's listen. Yoga by Björk on Classic Album Sundays Worldwide.
All these accidents that happen follow the dot. Coincidence makes sense only with you. You don't have to speak. I feel emotional landscapes. They pass on me. The riddle gets solved, and you push me up to this day. Inside of me, every nerve that hurts, you heal deep inside of me. Ooh, you don't have to speak. I feel emotional landscapes. They pass on me. I confuse.
Björk with Yoga from the album Homogenic, our classic album Sunday's album of the month. Now, one of my favorite songs on the album is the cinematic Bachelorette, which is part of our Isabel cycle, which started with Human Behavior from debut, in which the protagonist is like a little girl in the big bad city who meets all of the wrong people. I think I've been there. In Post, she relays how Isabel was magically born in the forest and uses instinct rather than the logic of city people. Bachelorette elaborates upon the story, and Björk relays, she's leaving the forest and she decides to go to the city to have a normal life. She tries her best and it doesn't work out, and she comes back to the forest and she's happier there. So this kind of parallels Björk's own life, as after recording Homogenic, she returned to her native Iceland. Now, Guy Sigsworth, you're in the studio here with me. What do you think of this song? Do you have any kind of 411, any story behind it?
I'm just a fan listening to it and enjoying it like everybody else does. I did meet Sean, who she co-wrote the lyrics with, to those. I think at least he definitely co-wrote. Isabel, did he co-write this one as well? I think he's a link. He's a notable Icelandic poet in his own right, mm-hmm. or novelist maybe even.
Yes, yeah. And do you think it has a real cinematic flavor?
Yeah, I think actually it's a wonderful sort of conceit to have a parallel story that sort of drips through three records like that. I think that's a really cool thing. I can't think of another album sequence where you have that kind of a thread through it.
Absolutely. I can only think of Ashes to Ashes.
Yeah.
David Bowie referencing Major Tom. And
something like that, maybe. Yes, yeah, that's true. Yeah,
that's about it. Another Bowie reference. I'm just trying to throw them all in there today. Let's have a listen. Bachelorette by Björk on Classic Album Sundays Worldwide.
We'll be right back.
Bachelorette from Björk's album Homogenic. This is Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and I'm in the studio with Guy Sigsworth, whose work with her on Post and Homogenic, Vespertine, Dancer in the Dark, and also as a musical director for her debut and Post tours. What have you learned from working with Björk?
I would say bravery, I think, especially musically. Don't always allow things to just... There's a kind of default way of doing things that there's always pressure to do it. It can be everything from where you put the instruments on stage in your live band. There's a default way that every crew wants you to set the instruments up, and even you want to put the drummer in a funny angle, they kind of don't like it, and you have to kind of fight for it. But it's like every little thing like that, it's when you've got a vision that's different, you kind of have to push harder for it. It doesn't mean you have to be aggressive. You can be very friendly and charming while pursuing it, but you have to be wary of this kind of inertia that pushes you back to the standard way of doing things. And I think it's great how she's kind of managed to resist that.
Yeah. I mean, also maybe as a woman, too, maybe she's had to be even more forthright with that. Mm. Is there anything that you learned from her that you actually brought into your own work?
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah.
Can you think of any examples?
I think I would take it as being more about a kind of being brave about trying new combinations of sounds and knowing when to resist formula. I guess. And it doesn't mean you resist all formulas, because, you know, Björk still writes songs with verses and choruses. So she's not a completely abstract artist.
Right. And there's hooks and everything else. Yeah.
But she also knows how to resist a certain kind of formulaic way of assembling a piece of music.
Now, this might be a similar kind of question with a similar answer, but how has she differed from other artists that you've worked with? Because you've worked with so many different kinds of people, which is really interesting.
Yeah. I think she's very much a complete musician. So she's not just, I mean, like some artists, I focus so much on the lyrics, they don't even notice everything that's not coming out immediately out of their mouth. You know, some artists are totally obsessed with beats, and then they miss other things. And I think she sees the whole picture, which is really important.
And how would you describe her musical vision?
I think it changes. I think she's become... She's changed as an artist. I think you can hear that her more recent records have taken her a long way from where she started. Mm. And that's what you want. I don't think she's an artist who repeats herself a lot.
Yeah, I agree. That's why she still has us on the edge of her seats every time she has a new album coming out.
Yeah. And I think that's kind of important, because I think my taste has always been more towards listening to albums, like I think Homogenic is, which have their own particular sound world. And it's not that that's going to be the sound world of every record that artist makes, but for that record they've constructed that sound world, and it's not just an assembly of whatever songs they had lying around at the time, it's that sound world.
Yeah, and that time, that moment in time as well, what's happening in your life.
Yeah.
I mean, some of the album is about relationships and failed relationships as well.
I mean, I do remember, like, I was also involved in Vespertine. I remember at the start of Vespertine, it was like, okay, now let's think of a sound world for this record that's completely unlike Homogenic, because it was like, we don't want to repeat that. Mm-hmm. So if Homogenic was about very massive sounds, as it was, with these distorted drums that sound like volcanoes or whatever, then that was, well, let's go very microscopic and very tiny and very detailed, because that's the other world we could go to, you know. And I think that's inspiring, to always keep yourself, fight your own cliches.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely. Well, it's kind of fitting to play the last song on the album as our last song on this show, and that's All Is Full of Love, on which you also worked.
Yeah, I just played some clavichord on that, and I'm a bit of a... I've got a big soft spot for the clavichord. It's a bitch for engineers to record, because it is the quietest instrument there is. And I mean, think of the quietest instrument you know, and then turn the volume like down 90% from that. So the engineers have to crank the microphones up so loud. But it's the one keyboard instrument that can play vibrato, because your hand, as you press the key, you're in contact with the string.
Oh, so interesting.
So it has this kind of expressivity. So I'm playing these sort of vaguely Japanese-y type cascading sounds on it.
Oh, how interesting. I grew up playing the organ, so Hammond, so you can hit that little vibrato switch, but that's a slightly different story.
No. As this means that you've got flexible vibrato, you know, under your fingers, and it's that's why I think it's a really interesting instrument, but it's a difficult instrument to play in public.
Yeah.
Because I've tried to play it in concert, and it's such a nightmare to mic it up.
I bet the room acoustics come into play there, I'm sure. Yeah. Well, we're going to have a listen to that. Thank you so much, Guy, for joining me in the studio. It's really been interesting to talk to you about your own work as well as working with Björk. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Next month, our album of the month is This It by The Strokes. So I hope you can join me then. But until then, this is Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and thank you for listening.
Given love, you'll be taken care of. You'll be given love. You have to trust it. Maybe not from around. It's all